Well, good morning. We have some of our folks are filtering in from the sharing time we had with Tim and Lois Hunter, who will be joining us here shortly. During our prayer time, we'll hear a few minutes from them if you're not able to join us for that this morning. But Tim and Lois have been connected to Fairview for 35 years plus together. And Lois said that she had actually been here in the 60s. You said 38? 58 for Lois. Yeah. So they've been connected to this a long time, and they're doing work in oral Bible translation. And they're still, I think, finishing up in the fellowship hall sharing on that. If you did not have a chance to attend, they'll be here. You can grab them after service and hear a little bit more about their ministry. But my name is Dan, and I do want to welcome you to Fairview. We're delighted to have you, especially on a rainy, cold day like this. Grateful, even though it is rainy and thundering, for how God provides for the earth. One of our prayer focuses this month is for creation care, and we see God caring for his creation and for us, demonstrated in the ways that he provides rain for the land, and we're grateful for his provision for that. I want to remind you, we do have a congregational meeting after this service. We're actually technically still open from the other service, but we're going to be voting on our nominating committee, our nominating team for elders and deacons. So that will be at the end of this service. And also, there's a number of announcements, so forgive me. We do have Easter Sunday. If you do end up going to the early service, it's going to be 15 minutes earlier at 8:45. Invite you to join us for that. And we do have the Easter egg extravaganza today, and it will not be outside. I have not heard confirmation of that, but I think it's safe to assume it will be inside as it was last year. So over in the fellowship hall, if you have kids or grandkids, please do bring them to that. I'd be delighted to have them. And lastly, I just want to remind you all that we do have a domestic mission trip going to Honeyapath, South Carolina, doing work with shut-ins and widows. And that'll be June 10th to 13th. Just please do see Andrew if you have any questions about that. This time, I'd like to invite you to worship with us. Please join me in our call to worship as printed in the bulletin and up on the screens. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. Now, I'm reminded this morning, as we go through our service and as I listen to Tim and Lois and one of the songs in our 9 a.m. service, that we do proclaim a story. A story that's been written down for us in the scriptures, but it is a story of God calling a people, revealing himself and who he is, and of a people falling and sinning and rebelling and deserving destruction and death, but being redeemed by the blood and the love of God poured out in Jesus Christ. And as we see this played out in our service, we do this with a call, with a confession, with an assurance. And at the end, as Christ sent his disciples out, so he sends us out, and we send you out into our community, into our world. And so join me in reminding ourselves and proclaiming this story of the gospel, and particularly of our need for Jesus in our prayer of confession. Pray with me. Eternal God, we recognize that your ways are mysterious. Teach us to be still and to wait for you. We confess our sinfulness, our need for control, and our discomfort with the unknown. Though you call us to be with you, we often prefer to work for you. You call us to be children and friends at your feet, but instead we cover our inadequacy and insecurity with busyness. We quench your spirit with hurry. Thank you for your patience with us. You never give up on us, O Lord. Surprise us this week with an awareness of your presence. Replace our fear with trust. Turn our anxiety into wonder. Give us your peace and joy, and draw near to us, Lord, that we might draw near to you. In the name of Jesus we pray, hear us as we continue our confession in silence. Pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now receive and respond to the assurance of pardon from Ephesians chapter 2. In Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility. For through him, we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. Thanks be to God.
Y'all may be seated, and where's everybody? And the children may head out with Miss Margaret. And if you were not in the fellowship hall for our Sunday school hour, then you may still know of or know about or know Tim and Lois Hunter. They spoke during Sunday school, and it's our pleasure to welcome them this morning. Lois, as Dan mentioned, we said how long we've known y'all, so they already know. But Lois was a member here as a girl, as a child, when her dad came to work at SRS in the mid 90s and 60s. It was flip. She and Tim have had a relationship with Fairview for a long time, and there was spoken worldwide. And I'd like to invite, just you, Tim, right? Well, Lois, you're welcome to come up too. But I'd like to invite Tim up to share about what they're doing with spoken and where they are in their ministry right now.
Translators.
Dawned on me, we don't have a microphone on this anymore.
Used to be one here time I was here. we started out with Wycliffe Bible Translators about 37 years ago, give or take, and worked with Wycliffe in Cameroon and in Chad for a while. Toward the end of that time, I started getting involved in oral Bible stories that helps people that don't have a chance to read or that prefer not to read. That's what we often talk about, is oral preference peoples. And long story short, I got recruited into an organization that's called Spoken Worldwide that works for those kinds of people. In fact, our organization began by training pastors orally that were in places where they were assigned to be in charge of a church, but they had no theological education or background that would, you know, give them a lot of material. And so we did it orally. So later on they said, you know, the real problem is we don't have scripture in our language. So Spoken said, well, we can do that orally too, can't we? And so that's where I came in, and I'm a consultant now with Oral Bible Translation, or OBT, as you might see in our newsletters if you get that. So I now run 5 projects in 3 in Nigeria and 2 in Ghana. I've got other assistants. I'm not doing it all by myself. Just still to say, I'm busier than I ever have been in Bible translation. And so we're just thankful for all that God is doing. Feels like really reaching people who have a huge need and who. You know of the gospel in rudimentary fashions, but really getting in down into the meat of, you know, who was Jesus and what did he say? And what does that have to do with us today anyway? Having them be able to hear it and understand in a way that is the way they've always done their life orally, including their education is oral, their history is oral, their land records are oral. And so when you give them the Bible oral, they go, yeah, well, this is easy. And we go, how can you remember all that stuff? They just do it. They've been doing it for a long time. And it works for them. I was doing checking with one of the groups in Nigeria, and we were going like phrase by phrase through it, them giving it to me in English of what they had said. And our CEO came that particular time and was sitting next to me. And I didn't realize, but this was the first time that he'd ever watched oral Bible translation getting checked. Because he had done the pastor training type stuff before. And so he said, I want to find out if the guy really knows it. And so I asked the translator, okay, would you tell me this whole passage that we've just been working on? And he stood up and rattled the whole thing right off. Boom, 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 boom. You know, not just a phrase at a time, without looking at anything, without any whatever. And this, Ed, the CEO, was going, wow, that's good. And so it is quite possible to do the Bible orally. And we're just really grateful that God's allowed us to do that. And thanks again for all that you folks have done and continue to do for this work we do. Thank you.
Well, thanks. And yes, we can clap. Thanks. And y'all are living in Texas now, but had been in Alabama and when you weren't in Africa.
Yeah.
So we did get that video, and y'all had moving boxes behind you, I think, in the last video that you sent us. Yeah. So thanks for being with us. Let's pray. I'll pray for the hunters, and we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for old friends who are doing well, doing new work and old work and work that's been going on for a while at your determination and blessing. And we thank you that Spoken and those who work there and many around them have seen the great benefit of approaching Bible translation in this way. For we know that you want your word to go out, and you want messengers who will go out and share the good news, just as we heard in our chapter for this month, Luke 10, a few weeks ago. And we pray that you will continue to bless Tim and Lois in their work, in their planning, in their sharing. Let their travels be safe, and let their endeavors be secure, because we know that there are some dangerous places where they may find themselves, or at least find themselves close to. And we thank you that you continue to bring them back here so that we may rekindle the relationships that we have. Thanks for the blessing that it is to have been a partner in this translation work for so long. And while they are working, let us be inspired as well, so that we may see how even something as simple as sharing a story or sharing words without having to have everything perfect and written down just right can be an entry point for people to know who you are and to know your Son. We pray that we may demonstrate Jesus's truth and grace in our lives as you send us out from here today, and help us to find the opportunities to bring others to an understanding of the grace that you've given. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, and we pray as he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you, choir. Thank you, Alan. Thanks, Dan and Tim and Lois. And thank you all for being here and making it. Continues to just, I mean, it's not a, you remember a few weeks ago, it was just pelting against this window. I haven't heard that, but we keep getting thunder. And all right, well, thank you all for making it, and be safe going out as well. So this is our last sermon in a series on Luke 10. Next week is Palm Sunday, and then we have Easter. But we've been in Luke chapter 10 through the season of Lent. And Luke 10 has a very evangelistic kind of tone to it from the start. And then we get into a couple other stories that open up some more inclination toward hospitality being a main theme. And we get that for sure today. We have the story of Mary and Martha. And you may have heard the story before, you may know the story. I'll back up though. The first part of the chapter is Luke 10, is Jesus sending out his disciples, into 72 of them, into towns and cities where he was going to be going. And he sent them out, telling them to extend peace, and if a person of peace received it, they would return the peace, and if not, then they can go to the next place, and their peace will return to them. And they were to sit and work with these people, alongside these people, developing relationships, and eventually proclaiming that the kingdom of God has come near. Now, if they were rejected, they'd just go ahead and say the kingdom of God has come near. But the point was that Jesus sent people out to the places where he's going to be going to let them know that the kingdom of God had come near. Soon after that, he's about to send them. Jesus tells his friends that he pronounces woes on a couple of cities and tells his friends that if things had been done in these far-off cities that we've done right where we've been, they would have immediately repented. But these close-by places haven't listened, so woe to them. And then they're sent out with that, but they come back proclaiming they've been able to cast out demons in Jesus' name, and that's wonderful, and Jesus is excited and praising. There's a nice little section in there where it's just very, very, very praise and thanksgiving oriented. And then we have the story of the Good Samaritan, which was last week, a story about a Samaritan, a begrudged and rejected person, walking along the road, yet being the one who extends mercy, who extends hospitality to someone who'd been beaten and robbed on the side of the road, even when a priest and a Levite, a church person, would not give the same courtesy out of concern for dirtying themselves, for making themselves unclean according to the law. But in that story, which Jesus told at the prompting of a lawyer, the lawyer understands the point of the story, and Jesus says, who was a neighbor to that man? And the lawyer says, well, the one who showed mercy, understanding that God's mercy is a way of understanding how we are to reach out, even when it might risk getting our hands dirty sometimes. So we come to the end of the chapter, Mary and Martha. It's a very short passage, and it's one that we might relate to if you've ever had to get your house ready for the Masters, because it's a story about getting the house ready. In Pittsburgh, they would say, redding up the house. Bill Bindorf's on sound today. He's from Pittsburgh. So redding up the house. It's Luke 10, verses 38 through 42. Let me pray before I read it. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and we ask that you will open our hearts and minds with your Holy Spirit so that we may receive it and so that we may seek your will. Speak to us so that we may do what we need to do, but also know how to simply be in your presence. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Luke 10, 38 through 42. Does it kind of sound like I'm in the bottom of a barrel or something? I'm getting an echo here. Are y'all okay? Okay. I don't know. All right. Now, as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving. And she went up to him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We've come full circle in the chapter. At the start of the chapter, Jesus was sending his friends with the message that the kingdom of God has come near. Well, now it's Jesus actually knocking on the door when Martha answers. So we've gone from the kingdom of God being near to the kingdom of God being here. And there's a distinction. In a different way, we respond in each case. But we've come from the end of the chapter with the kingdom being near to the beginning of the chapter, to the end of the chapter with the kingdom being here. Now, last week I talked about the difference between the ways that the Samaritan and the priest and Levite were traveling. In Jesus' story, he talks about the priest by chance coming across a man on the side of the road and a Levite doing likewise. They just happened to be going on their way without intention, which you might think would leave them more time to help the man who'd been beaten and bloodied and robbed, but it actually left them to continue just going on their own way and not put themselves in someone else's way who needed it. But the Samaritan was on a journey, and that stands to reason because Samaritans probably would not have had many reasons to travel aimlessly between Jerusalem and Jericho. It's not really their territory. But the Samaritan was on a journey, and because he was on a journey, he was actually more prepared to help, more prepared to nurse the man back to health, to provide for him. He was carrying money, he was carrying oil, he was carrying the things that the man would end up needing. He didn't realize when he started the journey that that's the reason he was carrying those things, but he understood how to use those things, the gifts and opportunities that God had given him when they came along. So this starts out by saying, by showing that Jesus and his disciples also were on an intentional journey. Now, Jesus was good friends with Mary and Martha and with their brother Lazarus, so they may have been expecting him. But either way, there was a point to what Jesus was doing and what the disciples were doing. They were going with intent. And verse 38 tells us, as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. So they're going with a purpose, and Martha does the welcoming. Now, in the coming verses, we see that Martha might seem to be less hospitable from a personal standpoint and more from a work and getting things done standpoint, but she was the one who answered the door. So she gives the nice personal greeting and welcomes them into the house. Now, at this point, we're in the level of formality, of custom. Hospitality was very important. You see laws and encouragements in the Old Testament about welcoming the foreigner and the stranger. That said, hospitality was not always practiced the way it was supposed to be practiced. Luke particularly is interested in this. If you go through the Gospel of Luke and see how people extend hospitality to Jesus, how Jesus extends it to others. And Martha is going by the book here. She welcomes Jesus and presumably his friends, his disciples, into the home. But then, as we find in a minute, she goes on to continue preparing and getting everything ready in the house. Now, contrast that with Mary, her sister, verse 39. And she had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. So we live in a bit of a different age where typically men share more of the household kind of duties. A lot of women work outside the home and inside the home. And we don't quite have the rigidity nowadays of social roles that they would have had back then. Now, back then, the home was also the workplace. It was the major economic unit. So work was often done in the home. And if a man and some other men are coming to the house, then it's expected that the man of the house is going to sit and converse while the women of the house, if there are no servants especially, while the women of the house are the ones who are going to be getting everything ready. making sure that everything is in order. So people who are reading this passage, people who are hearing it for the first time, would be a little shocked that instead of just going with Martha to help prepare things, Mary is just sitting at Jesus' feet and listening. They would have been predisposed to be anti-Mary at this point in the story because she's shirking her duties. She's not following through with the responsibility of a hostess, of someone who has people coming to the house, especially people they know and people who are friends. Because if it's you know, Jews hosting Jews, then there's not as much concern about being vulnerable with hospitality. No, you just go ahead and extend it. You go above and beyond what you might for somebody else, at least in practice. Whereas, you know, in God's word, it says to extend great hospitality to everybody. But culturally, this would have been a bit of a shock for Mary to just sit down at Jesus' feet and listen. So there'd be some alarm bells for people who are hearing this for the first time. But what Mary is doing is recognizing an opportunity. And she's recognizing the transition of what should be done when Jesus arrives. The change between the kingdom of God has come near and the kingdom of God is here. Because if the kingdom had just come near, then you've still got time to prepare. Not here yet. Go ahead and get things ready. Shove a few things in the closet and in the cupboard so it can't be seen. But now that the kingdom of God is here, I mean, it's Jesus here. What else are you going to prepare? The guests are here, so Mary sits down at Jesus' feet. So I have a question, and then we're going to look at some of the difference between Mary's response and Martha's response. The question is, Martha answered the door, Mary sits at Jesus' feet. Who is hosting? And if you were in the first service, don't answer. Who is hosting? Martha, who gets the door and welcomes Jesus and the others and then gets everything ready? Or Mary, who actually is present with Jesus and with the others? The one who's doing everything formally and customarily, or the one who's actually being present with the guests in the house? Who's really the one who is hosting in this story and in this situation? Well, Martha certainly had a sense of responsibility that it was her. And she felt a lot of pressure. Now, we might feel the same way. When we have people coming over to our house, we have to get everything ready. Everything needs to be prepared in time. But quite often, that doesn't fully become the case. And we welcome people into the house, and we have them sit down, and maybe somebody in the house can sit with them. But then we just keep getting things ready and preparing things and getting things in order, even after they've arrived. Even though the point is to have the people over, we continue preparing and getting ready. And once they're there, we get consumed by serving. And as the next passage tells, as the next verse tells us, Martha was distracted with much serving. And she went up to him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me." Martha was distracted with much serving. Now, it's one thing to be doing much serving. It's another maybe to be distracted with much serving. And she was maybe distracted by the pressure of it being the Lord in their house, distracted by a little bit of bitterness toward Mary, or just distracted by the need to get everything done and have it perfect. She feels like all the pressure is on her. And this is a stress response. She's focused on her own stress. But honestly, she's probably going to feel like all the pressure is on her anyway. Who do we have in here who's Team Mary? Who do we have in here who's Team Martha? The Marthas are always more willing to admit it. Good, because the Marthas get the instruction here. Even if we're often Team Mary, we probably have some Martha kind of tendencies in our lives. And it doesn't just have to be about getting our house ready. It could have to do with any of our relationships or work or hobbies, goals we have. We get so distracted by much doing, because serving is just Martha's expected role here. You can be distracted by much anything, much that you feel like you've got to do, much that you feel like you're expected to do. You can be distracted and can act out like this, stressed, upset, wanting Jesus to come and answer your stress according to your stress. Because that's what Martha does. Tells Jesus to respond to her anxiety and stress with the exact way that she wants her anxiety and stress to be responded to. And Jesus doesn't give exactly the response that she wants. But when we're in that kind of situation, whether it's about getting our house ready or not, it could be about all kinds of things in life, but we feel pressure. And when we feel pressure, we can get disoriented, distracted, frustrated. And when that happens, quite often our response is to just do more, and kind of get in a spiral of that pressure and frustration. And we want to do, and we want to do, and we want to do. And when we're anxious or we're disoriented or we're not sure what's going on, we feel like we can handle and control things by doing something else, even by serving, something that's ostensibly good but can be very distracting, something that we do just maybe because we don't know what else to do. One of my grandmothers had Alzheimer's, and as it was developing, as she was as the dementia was starting to form, she, it was probably the early to mid-90s, and she would just get consumed with trying to do something for anybody who was around her, because it helped her kind of control what she was doing and how she was responding to a situation. She could tell she was losing a little bit of control in her mind, so her response was to always be trying to control and do things with her hands or with her feet or for somebody else. And when I was in high school, she had gotten to the point where if we were in the same place, even if it wasn't her house, she felt like she always had to be getting you something. So she would ask, "Do you want a drink? Can I get you something?" And sure, have a drink. 5 minutes later, asking if there's anything she can do for us. Always feeling like she has to be doing something for somebody else, because that helps her keep control of herself. Now, we don't have to have a compromised mental state to have those kinds of reactions and feelings, though. She just didn't have a filter on it. Because we can overdo and not notice when Jesus is calling us to slow down and be present. Especially in a busy and fast-moving world, it can be easy to get disoriented or stressed or preoccupied and just miss how Jesus is calling us to be with Him. So Martha was distracted with much serving. But deep down, she probably wanted to be doing the same thing that Mary was doing. She probably would have liked to have just been able to sit at Jesus' feet. But from social pressure and from the pressure she put on herself, she wasn't able to do it. But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things." So Jesus understood Martha's frame of mind. But this isn't just a message to Martha. It's a message to everyone, everyone around, and all of us as well. "You are anxious and troubled about many things." And she was. She didn't have to act out like that, but she was. But instead of calling her out for acting out like that, Jesus just affirmed that he understood how she was feeling. Now, she's got her responsibilities. And she's pressured. And she wants everything to be perfect for Jesus. But nothing's ever going to be perfect enough for Jesus, to match Jesus, right? I mean, you're never going to get everything just... He's the only one who can be perfect. And maybe you can shove some things into cabinets or into closets, but Jesus knows what you have in your cabinets. Jesus knows what you have in your closets. You're not hiding anything from Jesus. Once Jesus is there, the point is to be present. Jesus knows what we have and what we're hiding in our closets. He knows how much clutter we have in our lives. Yet he still wants to come and be present with us. Still wants to welcome us to his feet. Still loves us anyway. Still willing to die for us, even knowing how much junk we've got in our closets. So, there's a transition, and I mentioned it a second ago, that's happened here, of going from the kingdom of God has come near to the kingdom of God is here. And Mary's realization is that once Jesus is there, that's the point. Martha's still consumed with getting ready, but Mary is free to just be with Jesus. Because once Jesus is there, that is the point. There's no other preparing. There's no point in trying to look perfect because Jesus knows that we're not perfect. That's why he came. That's why he's there. And we can get so consumed with the doing, or the pressures on ourselves, or what we even expect from ourselves, let alone what somebody else expects from us, that we can miss what we're really supposed to see. Because whenever we're doing something, inevitably we're missing something. It's good to have the serving and the preparation. It's good to do. It's good to be concerned about things being right. But so often in life, we let that distract us from the point of where God is leading us. Even in our relationship with God himself, sometimes we can be so consumed by getting things just right, the right reading plan, the right relationship that God wants me to work on this week, or the right thing to say to somebody else, the right way to pray, the right way to do all kinds of things, that we miss the fact that Jesus just wants to be present. Now, we have to be aware of his presence in order to recognize it, but quite often, getting consumed with everything being just right for us to be prepared to welcome Jesus into our lives can distract from the ways that he is in our lives. The little things, the common things, because those are quite often the things that Jesus uses to lead us closer to himself. If everything was a miracle or something remarkable, I don't know if we'd be able to handle it. The real beauty of following Jesus is just being able to sit at his feet and be welcomed there in spite of our own inadequacies and imperfections. So finally, Jesus gets to the point, not finally, it's a short passage, finally in the sermon. But one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. So Martha's response is about pressure. Mary's response is about presence. Recognizing that the point of having Jesus over to your house is to be with Jesus, not to have everything looking great for Jesus. Jesus is not going to share it on Instagram if he's impressed with your house. No. He wants to be with you. He wants to be with us. That's why he came over. That's why he came down. That's why he came to be with us. And Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. Because you know what can be taken away? A clean house. What can be taken away is a few minutes. what can be taken away is probably a lot of the stuff that we do and put pressure on ourselves for doing in life anyway. But what cannot be taken away is the time with Jesus. Because eventually he's going to walk out of the house and go somewhere else. Eventually he's going to go to the cross and be resurrected and rise. I asked Kelsey about this passage this week, and she talked about the pressure of trying to get things done in the house when all she really wants is to spend time with the kids. Because that's time that is much more fleeting. Anything going on in the house can be usually done another time, but it has to get done. And there's stuff that has to get done. So we do need to live in attention here. Because, you know, if we're just not worrying about being hospitable when Jesus shows up, then that's not good either. We should know how to prepare, know how to get ready. But then once he's here, we should know how to be present as well. So there's a tension here that we live in, of knowing that God is present, wants to be present. But we're also free to develop rhythms and patterns that help us to notice his presence, to share his presence, to communicate his presence. So yes, it's a tension. And in this particular instance, thankfully, Martha offered herself up to get held up as the example of how not to overdo it. But there is a tension. And as we go out into the world, it can be really tough sometimes to be openly present for God to do something. Because oftentimes it's not what we expect. Oftentimes, we may feel like we're not hearing direction from him at all. But even just being open is sitting at Jesus' feet. So back to the question, who is hosting in this situation? Because there's tension between Martha and Mary. They're both hosting in some way. Well, the answer is Jesus. Jesus is hosting. And that's what Mary really realized. That's the better portion. After all, what's the message at the start of the chapter? The kingdom of God has come near. And when Jesus shows up at the house, the kingdom of God is here. And if you're in the kingdom, who's hosting? The king. The king. It's his kingdom. Our houses, our lives, our relationships, his kingdom. He's hosting. And if we're spending all of our time trying to get our little granted portion of his kingdom in order and not just dwelling in it and appreciating it and realizing what he's set forth for us, then we're not accepting his invitation the way he fully would like us to be part of his kingdom, to recognize him and be with him and sit with him. That is the better portion, and it cannot be taken away. His kingdom is forever. So as we are in a really busy time for churches, for people in the Augusta area in general, let us consider how we can accept Jesus' invitation to be part of his kingdom wherever we might be. He happened to bring his kingdom into Mary and Martha's house in this passage, but he's brought his kingdom to every facet of our lives. And I would say to make a list of all the ways that you want to notice his kingdom this week, but that would be very Martha-like. But if you're a list-making type of person, that's fine. Just don't get distracted with too much list-making. But what you can do is pray and be aware and open to God's presence in our lives. Open to receiving it, recognizing it, open to sharing it. So when you look back at this passage, in this chapter, it's really hospitality-oriented. And we see that even though Jesus has come to be with us, he's also brought his own kingdom here and welcomed us into it. And he's gone on ahead of us to where his kingdom is fully present. He's given us the benefit in this life, though, to notice where his kingdom is particularly present and is becoming more known, and where we have the opportunity to make it known even more. Will you pray with me? Lord Jesus, help us to be in your presence. Help us to recognize not just where you are at work, but where you are sitting and dwelling in our lives and in our world. Let us accept your hospitality and set aside the distractions of our cares and concerns. Guide us through those cares and concerns so we may discern at which point we are faithfully following through with them and at which point we are allowing ourselves to be distracted from the other opportunities you provide. Send us out from here, communicating your kingdom, its truth and grace, its hospitality, and seeking, like the Samaritan, to be neighbors who show what your kingdom truly is. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Will you stand with me and let's join together in saying what we believe using the Apostles' Creed, our affirmation of faith printed in our bulletins and appearing on our screens. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. we'll give you a benediction, and those who are staying for the congregational meeting may stay, and then we'll have postlude after that. It won't be long. There's only one order of business. As you go from here, go as those who are already invited into the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God where Jesus is the host, inviting us all the time to sit at his feet. Go and do what you do well, but also go with an eye and a mind and a heart to finding where Jesus is calling you to sit and dwell. As you go, may the hands of Christ tend your wounds. May the Holy Spirit bring to your minds just the things that you need to hear. And may you dwell in the Father's arms at the last. Amen.